Hello, I'm Eric Snodgrass, and thank you for watching today's Ag Forecast brought to you by Nutrien Ag Solutions, your premier platform for real-time global insights. Well, over the past week, we've learned more and more about the severe weather outbreak from last Easter Sunday. I want to show you some research that was done by Professor Steven Strader here. He's from Villanova, where he looked down with high-resolution satellite at the change in NDVI. That's a satellite parameter I think a lot of us in farming are quite familiar with. But when you combine some of his research with a structural survey that was done by the National Weather Service and the latest updates from the National Weather Service out of Jackson, Mississippi, we've learned a lot about this particular tornado, and I want to zoom in here on this section of their article on it. This tornado that went through southern Mississippi is now the third widest on record. It hit a total path width of 2.25 miles. That puts it now in third place behind the El Reno, Oklahoma tornado, which is 2.6 miles wide, and the Halo, Nebraska tornado, which is 2.5 miles wide. I want to show you those. They're not exactly very photogenic because they're so wide, they almost completely fill the screen here, but this is just an incredible view of how big these tornadoes were that this new one from Mississippi now follows. Something interesting to tell you about these two tornadoes. Going back to 2004, the Halo, Nebraska tornado was ranked as an F4. That was because the enhanced Fujita scale, the one we use now, was not released until 2007. More than likely, had that tornado occurred in present day, the one that happened in Halo, Nebraska, it would have been ranked as an EF5. And here's also a little bit of interesting news about the widest tornado on record, El Reno, that was in Oklahoma in May 31st, 2013. Its official rating is an EF3, and that's because the greatest damage, which is what the enhanced Fujita scale is based upon, only matched EF3 rating. But we did have mobile Doppler radar on this one, and we actually were able to measure with radar wind speeds over 302 miles an hour, which would technically make that the second fastest wind we've ever observed in a tornado. Yet, the damage that it did, because it was largely in an unpopulated area, was only ranked at EF3. So a little bit of interesting news here about our three widest tornadoes on record. I just want to point out to you that now, because of that outbreak, look at it right here last weekend, we are now sitting well above average on tornadoes, and we're going into the kind of steepest part of this curve when you look at the trend line for the average daily accumulation of tornado reports across the United States. We certainly added more to that last night. You can see here by watching this animation here of infrared satellite temperatures that overnight last night, once again on Sunday, we saw severe weather breakout here from eastern Texas all the way through early this morning, where it was pushing through parts of, well, Florida, Georgia, and the Carolinas. And it was pretty nasty, and we're waiting to see what the tornado reports, storm reports, look like this morning. When looking over the weekend, not only did these storms produce a lot of severe winds and more tornado reports, there was a lot of hail in them as well, streaking across parts of eastern Texas through Louisiana, Mississippi, and Alabama. And when we looked early this morning, so this is a very preliminary here, we had already had 219 reports of severe weather, 8 of which were tornadoes. I expect this number to continue to grow today as the storms continue to progress overnight and we get more damage reports into the Storm Prediction Center. These storms produced a lot of lightning, over 200,000 strikes. And last night in the news, we heard about one of those strikes hitting the University of Alabama Tuscaloosa's music building, setting it on fire. And the fire was only contained within the roof from some of the latest news reports. And I believe they were able to save a lot of the instruments and equipment that was inside the building. But 201,000 lightning strikes out of this system as it pulled across the south. When we put it all into the broader perspective of things, let's just look back over the last weekend at total accumulated precipitation. This is a region that has been hammered since the start of the year in terms of very heavy rainfall. And our three-day totals here, well, there were some places underneath the heaviest rain where we were picking up 4+ inches of rain. And there might be a little bit of radar reflectivity bias in this, a little bit too high, but the potential existed for some of the storms to drop up to 6 inches of rainfall. So this has been the area that's been targeted not only for severe weather, but extremely heavy rainfall. So the context I want to add to this looks back over the last 14 days. While all the action has been in that area and in California, where it's been extremely wet, Southern California is off my charts here. That's greater than 550% of normal precipitation. Well, look outside of that. Dry in the Pacific Northwest, great start to the season there. Dry, although cold, here in the Central Plains. Dry in the Northern Plains, and even some pockets in the Central and Western Corn Belt that were dry as well. So thinking about that, let's look at it in terms of current calculated soil moisture anomalies. Where we've seen things dry out a bit has really been right in through here. So that would include parts of Iowa, Missouri, Illinois, Indiana, and parts of Ohio. Now, just to give you some perspective on this particular map, let me get that drawing off there. I now want to show you where April finished in 2019. So you can see considerable differences in soil moisture. And then watch this. This is April 19. This was May of 19. And this was June of 19. So the two big questions that loom in this forecast video for the United States and the Canadian prairies is the temperature pattern changing, and is the precipitation pattern changing such that we're going to get away from what we saw in 2019 and maybe get what we saw in 2018 across the midsection of the country, which was a decent warm-up and some good planting at the end of April through the beginning of May. So those are my two questions. Let's go right on into them. Precipitation first. We have on the left the GFS model. We have on the right the European. And the map you're looking at here, or the maps you're looking at here, show the next week's worth of precipitation compared to normal. So these are precipitation anomalies. And what we're seeing here is that the current GFS model run is much wetter with the system coming through here and there, and I'll show you the timing on those two systems soon. And the European is much more aggressive with the southern wave, increasing the severe weather threat again this week across this area. What the models do agree on, though, much of California going to be on the drier side of things. This section of the United States in through here, overall on the drier side of things, which means I expect to see a lot of field work, planting, things really going there. But when you come down to parts of, well, the southern half of Kansas, the southern half of Missouri, Illinois, and the Ohio Valley, there does appear to be increased chances of precipitation throughout this week. So we're going to dive into those details in just a few moments. What about week two? Well, pretty sizable pattern adjustment into week two as a broader trough comes sweeping in like this, builds into a ridge that cuts over the top, and then digs into a trough again that comes in this direction. And because of that flow pattern following something like this, which I'm drawing on the European side of model now, we do see that week two shows up drier than normal. Doesn't mean no precipitation, but drier than normal across a big section of the United States. So that is a critical piece of information as we're moving now into this time period of rapid field work and planting across the main ag belt in the central part of the United States. Question number two, what are we going to do about these temperatures? Because over the last week, as the ridge built into Alaska and into Greenland, taking all that heat there, we saw deep cold plummet through the Canadian prairies and all the way down to the Gulf of Mexico. And so when we look out over this next week, let's look at both of our models again. On the left, I have the GFS ensemble looking at temperature anomalies. And on the right, I have the European. Very similar story here. Look at the warm-up coming from the Canadian prairies down into the northern prairies of the United States. And the cooler bias that we're hanging on here through the Great Lakes states into the Northeast is substantially less than what we saw with the previous cold snap last week. So temperatures are moderating in that area. Now, my concern at this point is going to be over two things. Are we getting our overnight temperatures down below freezing? And what are our soil temperatures doing? So let's talk about those two things with respect to temperature. Monday morning lows, you can see here when compared to normal, we did bring our freezing temperatures. Look at that cold pocket right in through there. And you can see the numbers which represent the minimum temperatures where we were below freezing. So as we play this forward, let's just take a look at how things evolve throughout this week. So this is now getting into Tuesday morning lows. So we have another quick shot at some colder air coming in here Tuesday morning, spreading through the Ohio Valley and into the Northeast by Tuesday during the day and then Wednesday morning. So the cold air that you see coming in here, look at where it moves on Wednesday morning. There it is. But this begins now the considerable warm-up for the whole of the western half of the United States. So this is Wednesday morning's lows. Now getting into Thursday, Friday morning lows, Saturday morning lows, and Sunday. So you can see the western part of the United States clearly going over to a much warmer pattern. And over the eastern two-thirds of the country, when we do have shots at cooler air, they're nothing compared to the magnitude of the cold we endured last week. So from there, let's take a look at those soil temperatures. Now, these are modeled soil temperatures. This is what things look like right now, Monday morning, 7 a.m. And if you just pause the video, you can look at the color bar at the bottom and get a good snapshot of your area. What I want you to see is the difference between now and what we're projecting for Friday morning. If I toggle back and forth, you can see considerable warming across the central plains in terms of those soil moisture temperatures at 4 inches. And that combined with the drier conditions we are expecting to see in parts of the plain states and in the western and central corn belt means we're going to see quite a bit of field activity this week. All right, going beyond that quickly here, day 6 through 10, on the left from the GFS, same thing on the right from the European model. At this particular point, the flow of the jet stream, like we talked about, was going to build into a ridge here with a trough over the east. The good news is these temperature anomalies that we're seeing here are not as cold as what we saw from the previous shot at cold air that came through. And I think right now that the GFS is biased a bit more cold than the European is at this point. So you can see the differences here. Okay, what's that pattern doing? You can see it right here. Ready? By day 10, there's the deeper trough building into a broader ridge and dipping over here. So this is the warm-up that we're seeing in the west. This is the convergent flow in the jet stream coming from the northwest, which is why we saw that pocket in through there dry. But where this met up with the subtropical jet stream, we still saw this area showing up wet. Now getting us there is this. Later on today, this is what the flow of the jet stream is going to be. So the near-term things I want to be watching with you is where this trough is going. As it moves here toward Alaska, that is going to be beneficial to the west warming up. We're going to see this deep trough over the Hudson Bay also move to the east. And as it moves to the east, that allows the warmth to spread from the west with it, behind it. But we do have to watch out for this little shortwave trough, which right now is sitting right here. And that's the one I'm concerned about as it sweeps across the United States, kicking off yet again a severe weather threat for the southern United States. In combination with that, coming over this ridge, see this piece right here? This will dive down into the Great Lakes states and emerge here, increasing chances for strong to severe storms along the eastern seaboard as well. And with it, some cooler air that might be bringing in some more snow to the very northern parts of the United States. So we've got a lot to be paying attention to here. Let's dig right on into it by looking at the severe weather threat first. Now, those overnight hour storms, which we started off with, still have left on Monday morning the greatest severe weather threat in coastal parts of Georgia, South Carolina, and getting back up into North Carolina. As we then progress into the day on Tuesday, the areas we want to watch again are the Northeast and then the next system emerging here out of the Rocky Mountains into the South Central Plains coming through parts of Texas and Oklahoma. From there, our Wednesday severe weather threat from the Storm Prediction Center begins in parts of eastern Oklahoma and Texas and spreads over toward Mississippi. And just to show you, we have our own kind of proprietary severe weather index developed here at Nutrien Ag Solutions, and this is its forecast for those Wednesday night storms as well. And of course, they will spread this direction in the overnight hours. So we can see pretty good agreement between our forecasting model and what the Storm Prediction Center is saying. Now, at this particular point, the Storm Prediction Center has not yet, as of very early in the morning on Monday, made a call about Thursday's severe weather threat, but we want to show you what our index is showing. It appears that by Thursday afternoon, the strong thunderstorm threat will move over toward parts of Alabama, Georgia, South Carolina, and Florida. So at this point, it's something we need to watch for the end of this week on Thursday afternoon and evening to see if that severe weather threat does translate farther to the east where we early this morning have all that severe weather. So speaking of that early morning severe weather, it is right here when we stop at 6 a.m. So we can see that that low is still pushing its main front right up through the coast here. Colder rain on the backside of this, but severe weather out ahead of it. Now, meanwhile, what we're watching beyond this is going to be this. Remember that trough that was pulling here out of the Canadian prairies? We're going to watch this low pressure system move through the Great Lakes, and then the next one emerge right here in parts of Texas, Oklahoma toward the end of this run. So this is 6 a.m. Let's get you through mid-morning. This is where that light snow was coming through parts of the Dakotas around the Red River Valley. And as we play this forward, that does move into parts of northern Minnesota, Wisconsin, and some cold rain this afternoon for these two states. That then pushes over into Michigan, as we can see here. And by 9 o'clock tonight, why these scattered showers to the south of it across parts of Illinois, Indiana, and Missouri. Now, at this point, if you step back, you can see some widely scattered showers coming out of California and then emerging here as a wave over the four corner states. At the same time, the first system that pulled through parts of Michigan is now pushing through the northeast, increasing the chances for strong to possibly some severe storms on its frontal boundary here as well. So that pushes through the northeast and mid-Atlantic by the time we get into Tuesday afternoon, bringing some scattered showers through parts of Virginia and into parts of North Carolina. But the next round really starts to show up right in through here as a quick shot at some snow Tuesday night may move through like Duluth into parts of northern Wisconsin and the UP. So this next system, as it emerges right here by 7 a.m. on Wednesday, is going to be the one we're going to be watching most carefully as it progresses across the south. And to see where it goes, let's go right over to the European model. So pressing play, let's pause it here where we've seen through. That takes us right into Wednesday morning. So the light snow possibly moving through parts of Wisconsin into the lower part of Michigan. We then see feeding on the flow coming around this high straight out of the south, bringing that moisture and heat back into this next low here, such that by Wednesday afternoon and evening, just as the Storm Prediction Center had suggested, we're going to be watching for the chance for strong to severe storms in this vicinity. Texas, Louisiana, Arkansas, getting over toward Mississippi. You see that as we pull this forward, the northern extent of the rain seems to clip right here south of about I-70, but we do have some showers up here along the I-80 corridor. As we move forward into the next day, this is Thursday morning, Thursday afternoon and evening, you can see why our severe weather index was picking up on the chance for those severe storms to then spread on Thursday from parts of Alabama over toward Georgia, Florida, South Carolina, North Carolina. All right, so we were watching that carefully. You then see by Thursday evening just general area of lighter showers here moving across parts of the Central Plains. This is not a soaking event at this point, but the models are picking up on the chance for some precip. And that then spreads by the time we get through the day on Friday over toward the Central Corn Belt and through this area. Remember, we said this was going to be drier than normal, but not completely dry. But a lot of folks will get missed by the rain that you see forecast here for Friday evening. As we work our way into Saturday morning, that low begins to pull through parts of the northern part of the Ohio Valley and then on off toward the north and east. But just a note here, we could have some cool enough temperatures early Saturday morning to possibly see some snowflakes fly here if this low pressure system is in fact going to materialize right here over Indiana and Ohio at this time. A lot of uncertainty. We're pretty far out in the forecast at this point. So that's how things look at over the next little while. Again, let's now just look once again at week two. Remember, during week two, we saw a broad sector of the United States showing up on the drier side of things. And that's because the jet stream was doing, like we said, something like this. So the moisture was coming into the Pacific Northwest, avoiding California. Upper level convergence in the jet stream here, overall drier pattern. And all I say by drier is no major huge low pressure systems moving through the country. That same pattern returns warmth to a broad sector here of the western two-thirds of the country, while the eastern third is still sitting with a cold bias as we go into the first week of May. So that's how things are shaping up once we stretch this out now into basically out to about May 4th. Okay. From there, I'm going to give you a quick global perspective. The colder air that you see sitting here over the next 5 days in this section of North America is also reflected in the upper level wave pattern here in parts of the Russian wheat belt in Ukraine. We see the cold anomalies there, and also here over China, big section of China experiencing much below average temperatures as well. From there, I want to talk about South America. I've been showing you for the last several weeks the soil moisture anomaly maps from the SMAP satellite, and we've been paying attention to very dry conditions here in southern Mato Grosso, Mato Grosso do Sul, then getting down into Parana and Rio Grande do Sul. Zooming in specifically on this area right here, I made a graphic that looks back over the last 180 days so we could start to see when that drying really began to take shape. And it happened here toward the beginning of March. We had a dry spell down there where it wasn't too much to talk about at that point because of all the precipitation leading up to it. And then we got a brief shot at some rain, but it's been since then two other plateaus of much below average precipitation that has really dried out that section of Brazil. And that's where we've heard the most problems with the first crop finishing and some of the safrinha crop down in that area. Also, this region showing up quite dry as well has been having problems. As we forecast forward for South America, look at this. The European model, same with the GFS, over the next week, massive donut hole over that same area, missing out on precipitation. Some of Argentina's growing areas are expected to get rain this week, as is Brazil's northern growing regions. So where we got a lot of that safrinha crop right in through here, we can see that decent precipitation. But getting out into week two, that's the map over there on the right. Once again, very dry in those southern Brazil growing areas. Argentina, though, picking up some more precipitation. So this could impact harvest efforts in Argentina, but overall, this is a finish to a very dry end of the growing season here for southern Brazil. With that, we're going to wrap it up right there. I hope you all have a great week. Look forward to talking to you each day this week. Have a good one. We'll talk to you again soon. Thank you.